Hello everyone, welcome to the fourth session in this lecture series on genetics and molecular biology. I am Dr. Yogesh Pawde. We have so far covered structure and function of nucleotides, biologically important nucleotides and their clinical significance, and in the third session we have covered structural analogs of those nucleotides with their significance. Now coming to the fourth session, which is also coming under BI 7.1, which deals with the structure and functions of DNA and RNA and the cell cycle. In this particular session, we are going to cover what are chromosomes, nucleosomes and histones. But what is the importance of this topic? Now we are going to understand structure of DNA and RNA. To understand the structure of DNA, it is pertinent to understand what are chromosomes, what are nucleosomes, what are histones and what are non-histone proteins which are associated with DNA and RNA. The specific learning objectives which we have kept for this session are: at the end of the session, phase 1 MBBS students shall be able to describe structure and functions of chromosomes, structure and functions of nucleosomes and describe structure and functions of histones. Coming to karyogram, what is karyogram? This is a result of karyotyping. It is described according to the location of the centromere. You know, these are the types of chromosome which are observed under metaphase. Depending on the location of the centromere in the chromosome, these are named as submetacentric, metacentric or acrocentric. And this is the karyogram which displays the complete chromatin of an organism. But what is chromatin? Chromatin is the generic term for any complex of DNA and protein found in a cell's nucleus. That is a chromatin. The number of different chromosomes, these are different chromosomes and the associated DNA content, varies greatly between species. Each type of chromosome in a cell contains its own type of DNA molecule. There are many different linear DNA molecules in eukaryotic nuclei, each present in a very few copies. This particular chromosome, you know, is a single DNA molecule. This is a metacentric chromosome. The centromere is more or less in the middle. In acrocentric chromosomes, the centromere is very close to one end. This end or this end. The chromosomes always have two arms separated by a centromere, but the relative sizes of the two arms can vary in different chromosomes. These are observed in metaphase of cell cycle. Okay, cells in metaphase can be fixed, okay, and those are stained with one of several dyes that highlight the chromosome and accentuate the centromere. Here with a particular dye they are highlighted, and the dyes also produce a characteristic banding pattern. If you can see here, the characteristic banding pattern is seen, which is made up of lighter and darker regions. The chromosomes that match in size, shape and banding are called homologous chromosomes. So these are homologous chromosomes. These are homologous chromosomes. The two homologs of each pair contain same set of genes. So these are homologous chromosomes, and each one of the two or each one of the pair will contain same set of genes. Although for some of those genes they may carry different alleles, you know, the genes may have different alleles. The differences between alleles, right here, the differences between alleles occur at the molecular level, and you know, it is not observed under the microscope. Okay, so alleles will not be observed, though the banding is same, but it may contain different alleles. To study the chromosomes of a single organism, the geneticists arrange micrographs of the stained chromosomes. These are the stained chromosomes, okay, and the geneticist will rearrange these chromosomes according to their size, shape and banding pattern, and they make homologous pairs of the chromosomes. Size of the chromosome is decreasing, okay, right from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So up to Y, if you can see, the size of the chromosome is decreasing. And here, you know, there are 44 chromosome pairs which are known as autosomes, and there are two unmatched. This one is X, this one is Y. The X chromosome is bigger than Y. These are two unmatched sex chromosomes. A single Y chromosome specific gene, that is called as SRY gene. A single Y chromosome specific gene, that is sex determining region of Y, is the primary determinant of maleness. And SRY is one of about 110 protein coding genes on the Y chromosome, and it is a primary determinant of maleness. X and Y chromosomes, though they differ in size and shape, and those are unmatched sex chromosomes, but the two ends of Y chromosomes and X chromosome, so ends of X and Y chromosomes will have homologous DNA sequences, which are known as pseudo-autosomal regions or PARS, PARS. Pseudo-autosomal regions are the regions on X and Y chromosomes which have homologous DNA sequences. This was regarding karyogram. Now coming to chromosome. Just now we have seen what is chromatin. It is the generic term for any complex DNA and protein found in a cell's nucleus is a chromatin. And what is chromosome? Each chromosome is a piece of chromatin that contains a single linear, very long, double-stranded, negatively charged DNA molecule without breaks or changes of polarity, intricately packed with positively charged histone proteins and various other non-histone proteins. Now we have split it into a single linear. So each chromosome will have a single DNA molecule. It is linear, it is very long, and it will be double stranded. DNA is negatively charged molecule, and it is without breaks, or there is no change in the direction, and it has to be intricately packed with positively charged histone. So negatively charged DNA and positively charged histone will have interaction, and the condensation, the intense condensation of DNA molecule in this chromosome will be possible. So here in this diagram, this is chromosome. If that is unfold, you see the condensation was so intense, right? So the DNA molecule, the single DNA molecule is condensed so effectively on these histone proteins and forming a nucleosome. And here, after, you know, unwinding, you find a double stranded single linear DNA molecule, and it is intricately packed with histone molecules here. And these histone molecules, they help package DNA into chromatin, and non-histone proteins function in chromosome structure, replication and segregation, as well as in the control of gene expression. So there are various other proteins rather than histone are also present, which, you know, determine chromosome structure, the replication process, and helps in segregation as well as in the control of gene expression. Coming to nucleosome. Nucleosomes are the building blocks of chromosomes. Why are nucleosomes required? Why are histones and non-histone proteins are required? So for sufficient folding and compaction of DNA, it depends on interaction with two categories of proteins, histones and non-histone chromosomal proteins. The nucleosome is composed of a core of 8 histone proteins, and DNA is wrapped around them. Here there are 8 histone proteins and this DNA is wrapped around it. Okay, so we'll explain this diagram in subsequent slides. The DNA between each nucleosome is called a linker DNA. Okay, this is nucleosome and this is also another nucleosome, and this part of DNA is the linker DNA. and the DNA which is wrapped around histone protein is histone core or histone protein is called as core DNA. So core DNA and linker DNA. This is the first stage of DNA packaging, and it is essential for all the remaining levels of DNA compaction. So wrapping DNA around histone core is the first step of DNA compaction. The DNA most tightly associated with the nucleosome is called as core DNA and is wrapped around about 1.65 times around the outside of the histone core or histone octamer here. The 147 base pair length of core DNA is an invariant feature of nucleosome in all eukaryotic cells. So what is common here is the core DNA length, which is 147 base pairs only, and that is not changed during the evolution. So core DNA length is not changed during the evolution. This is very important point. What is changed then? In contrast, the length of the linker DNA between nucleosome is variable. So this length of linker DNA, you know, it determining lot many differences which are present between different types of eukaryotic cells. Typically, this distance is 20 to 60 base pairs, and each eukaryote has a characteristic average linker DNA length. So one cell may have 20, another cell may have 30. Okay, so different types of eukaryotic cell will show you different lengths of linker DNA, but all eukaryotic cells will have 147 base pair length of core DNA, which is wrapped around histone core or histone octamer. In any cell, there are stretches of DNA that are not packaged into clone to nucleosome. The differences in average linker DNA length is likely to reflect the differences in larger structures formed by nucleosomal DNA in each organism rather than differences in the nucleosome themselves. So this is a nucleosome, and differences in the structure of nucleosome is not that, you know, predominant. What is predominant and what is manifesting is differences in the linker DNA length in different eukaryotic cells. Okay, so this is very important point. Typically, these are regions of DNA engaged in gene expression, replication or recombination. Although not bound by nucleosomes, these sites are typically associated with non-histone proteins also that are either regulating or participating in these events. Which are they? DNA polymerase, DNA helicase, etc. These are non-histone proteins. They are either regulating or participating in these events. By assembling into nucleosomes, the DNA is compacted approximately six-fold. So the first step of DNA compaction compacts DNA approximately six-fold. Okay, so at the level of nucleosome, you can say that DNA is six times folded, or six-fold compaction is there. You know what level of compaction an average eukaryotic cell shows? It is 1000 to 10,000 fold DNA compaction is observed. So it is highly condensed DNA molecule. What are the further condensation levels of DNA after nucleosome? The supercoiled DNA with histones or nucleosomes will have a diameter of about 10 nanometers. A group of such nucleosomes form the DNA fibril. About 6 such fibrils are further supercoiled to form 30 nanometer diameter chromatin fibers or chromatin threads. By this time, the DNA is folded about 100 times. In interface chromosomes, chromatin fibers condense to 1 lakh base pairs loops anchored in some supporting matrix that is called as nuclear matrix. So in interphase chromosomes, you know, there will be again another level of condensation. So it will condense to 1 lakh base pair loops. Then coming to the histones. The histones are relatively small proteins with a preponderance of small basic positively charged amino acids lysine and arginine. Because of the positively charged amino acid, the strong positive charge of histone enables histones to bind to and neutralize the negatively charged DNA molecule throughout the chromatin. The histones make up half of all chromatin protein by weight and are classified into 5 types: H1, H2A, H2B, H3 and H4. The last 4 types, H2A, H2B, H3 and H4, form the core of the most rudimentary DNA packaging unit, the nucleosome. These last 4, you know, are components of histone core, and these are the most rudimentary DNA packaging unit that is called as nucleosome, the first stage of condensation of DNA, and are therefore referred to as core histones. So which are core histones? H2A, H2B, H3 and H4. Except H1, all remaining 4 are core histone proteins. These all 5 types of histone proteins appear throughout the chromatin of nearly all diploid eukaryotic cells, and they are very similar in all eukaryotes. We have seen that during the evolution, the histones have changed so little throughout the evolution, underscores the importance of their contribution to chromatin structure. The protein core of the nucleosome is a disc-shaped structure that assembles in an ordered fashion only in the presence of DNA. Without DNA, the core histones form intermediate assemblies in solution. So the H3 and H4 histones first form heterodimers that then come together to form H3H4 tetramer with 2 molecules each of H3 and 2 molecules of H4. In contrast, H2A and H2B dimer, they form only dimer, they do not form tetramer. So the assembly of a nucleosome involves the ordered association of these building blocks. First, the H3H4 tetramer will be formed. It will bind to DNA. Then 2 H2A to B dimers join the H3H4 DNA complex to form the final nucleosome. And the association of histone octamer, this tetramer means 4 chains, and 2 dimer molecules means again 4 chains. So this is octamer. This histone octamer with DNA protects the DNA from digestion by a nuclease. So its importance in chromatin was underrated or under evaluated, but it is very important because it protects DNA from digestion by a nuclease. Now coming to H1, histone H1, its molecular weight is 21 kilodalton, is not part of the nucleosome core particle. H1 binds to the linker DNA, that's why it is also called as linker histone. So octamer is formed by these 4 histone proteins, H2A, H2B, H3, H4. H3H4 forms tetramer, binds to DNA, and H2A, H2B forms a dimer only. It does not form tetramer, but it binds. When it comes to bind to DNA, 2 dimer molecules will bind to H3H4 DNA complex. And H1, as we know now, that H1 binds to the linker DNA, it is called as a linker histone, it is not a part of histone octamer. So this is very important MCQ. The 4 core histones are present in equal amounts in the cells. H1 is half as abundant as the other histones. So H3, H4, H2A, H2B, these are present in equal amounts. H1 histone protein is half of that. Only one molecule of H1 can associate with a nucleosome. Only one molecule of H1 will associate with nucleosome. So one nucleosome, one molecule of H1. The histones have a high content of positively charged amino acids that we have seen, that is lysine and arginine. At least 20% of the residues in each histone are either lysine or arginine. The core histones each have an amino terminal extension called a tail. This is core histone and these are the amino terminal tails because it lacks a defined structure and is accessible within the intact nucleosome. The exposed amino terminal tails are not required for the association of DNA with the histone octamer. The tails are the sites of extensive post-translational modification that alters the function of individual nucleosomes. The amino terminal extensions, called as tails, have no role in association of DNA with histone octamer, but it is very important for extensive post-translational modification that alters the function of nucleosome. And which are the post-translational modification? These are phosphorylation, acetylation, methylation on serine, lysine and arginine residues. So altering these amino acids will have different individual nucleosome function. Coming to non-histone protein, the remaining half of the mass of a protein in eukaryotic cell chromatin is not composed of histones. Rather, it consists of thousands of different kinds of non-histone chromosomal proteins. The chromatin of a diploid genome contains 200 to 20 lakh molecules of each kind of non-histone protein. So, see the variety of non-histone proteins. We have seen histone proteins. They are only 5, H1, H2A, H2B, H3 and H4. Here the non-histone proteins have a tremendous variety. And why this variety is required? Because it has to fulfill many different functions. Which are those functions? Some non-histone proteins play a purely structural role, helping to package DNA into more complex structures to form the structural backbone or scaffold, such as DNA polymerase. And other enzyme proteins also are there, which are active in replication process. These are crucial for chromosome segregation. For example, there are proteins of kinetochores. They segregate chromosomes, and that is very important function of these non-histone proteins. These motor proteins of kinetochore help move chromosomes along the spindle apparatus and thus expedite the transport of chromosomes from parent to daughter cells during mitosis and meiosis. They regulate transcription during gene expression by influencing when, where, and how frequently genes are transcribed. By far, the largest class of non-histone proteins constitute those which foster or regulate transcription during gene expression. You know, mammals carry more than 5,000 different proteins of this kind, which will regulate transcription during gene expression. So here we have covered karyogram, chromosomes, nucleosomes, histones and non-histone proteins, and this is the literature which is used for this compilation. Thank you so much. Thanks for watching this video. If you really like the content, please hit like button and share the video, and please subscribe to the channel and hit the bell button and making all notifications on so that you will not miss any notification of the upcoming video. Thank you so much. Keep watching. Keep motivating us.